you be seated. Turn with me, please, to your Bible, to Matthew chapter 13. And I want to try, if I can tonight, to explain some things. Let me get this. Now, I want to try this evening to put some things in a perspective for us that I believe will help serve us. The title of my talk is called Finding the Real You. Some of you may not want to do that. But I'm reading from Matthew 13, and I'll tell you who the real you is before we get started, so you won't be too nervous. Matthew 13, 37, 38, and this is Jesus summarizing something, kind of a whole cosmic plan of what God is doing. And he answered and said, "The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and as for the good seed, these are the sons of the kingdom." Now, I would like to do something very seldom done, but I would like to insert in there the sons and the daughters of the kingdom. Now, as you know, the word sons is used generically, but I want to use it carefully tonight because I want every woman, young and old, to be able to understand that this challenge is for all of us equally. And so I'll repeat that as I go on. Now, he said, the field is the world. And as for the good seed, now when you want to know what is being sown, you have to remember it's not only God's word, but God's people. It is a son of the kingdom that is being planted. Now, there's another son here, and we have to recognize him. And he said, and the sons of the kingdom, and this is verse 38, the last part of the verse says, and the tares are the sons of the evil one. So there are three sons. There's the Son of Man, who is Jesus. There is the son of the kingdom, and the third one is the son of the evil one, meaning these are all three very mature men and women. Jesus is the mature Son of God, and the sons of the evil one are men and women who have grown up and are mature in evil things. And the challenge for you and me is that you and I grow up and that we're mature sons and daughters of the kingdom. So that's the challenge. Acts chapter 14 verse 22. Let me show you a verse that has absolutely, literally changed my life. And I wish that I could do more tonight on the kingdom, but we're going to touch some things about the kingdom. And then a little bit later, I'm going to make my daughter and my staff nervous because I'm going to offer you something here free, all right? Because I did a thing some while back on the difference between the church and the kingdom. I did quite a study and I wrote a little paper. And so in a little while, I'm going to offer you a paper which will explain the difference between the church and the kingdom. And it will help you, all right? Acts 14, verse 22. Very quickly now, we want to touch something that is exceedingly important, I believe. After they had preached the gospel, verse 21, and made many disciples, they returned to Lystra, Iconium, and Antioch. Verse 22, now here's the three things they were doing. One, they were strengthening the souls of the disciples. Two, they were encouraging them to continue in the faith. The word encouraging is a special word, a military word, which means courage for the battle. Very beautiful word in Greek. Now, the third one is their message. Their message is a message that has not been clearly enunciated in the last 25 years or so, especially in the churches as we know them. The third part of their message was this, saying, through many tribulations, we must enter the kingdom of God. Now, I was a professor at Elam, the Bible college that's being advertised here in the lobby. Beautiful school, marvelous place where God is very, very real present. And I was a teacher there, and I loved it very much. And it was there, 1963, that I was teaching the book of Acts, and it hit me, something hit me like a sledgehammer, and it was this. Salvation is free, and I'm saved by faith. The kingdom of God is entered by tribulation. And I started on a search, trying to find and make that distinction. And so I want to talk to you. The word tribulation here, it very simply interpreted means made narrow by pressure. That's how the word translates. It means made narrow by pressure. And so he said, you, through many tribulations. Now, how many here feel that it is honest to teach people what to expect? You understand, it's very important that we teach people what to expect. And so when I said on the first night, doesn't Thursday night seem like a long time ago? I mean, it seems like last month almost. But I said there's a certain kind of suffering. And what I want to try to do tonight is try to explain to you why tribulations are essential or necessary for us to enter the kingdom of God, all right? Next scripture is Luke chapter 3, verse 3 through 6, all right? And Luke chapter 3, and these are familiar portions to most of us, but look with me, please, at Luke chapter 3, and I'm going to read a scripture that is given in all three or all four of the Gospels, but it's most complete in the book of Luke. Luke chapter 3, verse 3, and we're reading through verse 6. And I've got an unusual kind of thing going on in me tonight, and I feel a little nervous, and I'm praying that God would allow us to get this thing out and get the picture as I believe the Lord has given it to us. Verse 3 of Luke 3, it came to all the district around Jordan. This is John the Baptist preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sin. As it is written in the words of Isaiah the prophet, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make ready the way of the Lord. He make his paths straight. Every ravine shall be filled up. Every mountain and hill shall be brought low. The crooked shall become straight, and the rough roads shall be made smooth. Now, interesting tonight, the prophetic word said, don't you try to outguess the road. Don't you evaluate this by your natural mind, but allow the Lord to show us some things in this. Now, these three statements is what I'm building the rest of what I want to say to you on. One, it goes like this. God is ultimate reality. Right? God himself is ultimate reality. Number two, to dwell in God's presence, we must approach reality. God is ultimate reality. Second, to dwell in God's presence means that we have to approach reality. All right? Third, now this is important, the closer we get to reality, the closer we are to God. Are we thinking? Now what? God is ultimate reality. In order to dwell in God's presence. Now how many know there's a difference between dwelling there and visiting there? All right, remember that the other night? Now, a lot of us have visited there, and some of you have been to conference before. Remember me telling about many charismatics have what I call rooftop experience. That is, rain comes on somebody else's house, they put a spout up on their house, and it rains and it comes down on them, and they say, but that's not yours. You got it from somebody else. So that ultimate reality, now watch, God is ultimate reality. In order for us to dwell in God's presence, we have to approach reality. And as we approach reality, here's how I'm measuring this. The closer I get to reality, the closer I am to God. Now, here's what I want to try to picture. Now, I can't deal with all four of these, but there are four things, four ways that God brings reality. One, he brings the ravine or the valley up. Whatever is sunken, that is below, he brings that up so that it's flat and plain. Whatever is a hill or a mountain that is above or exalted, he brings that down. How many can see a little suffering in that? If he brings this up and he brings that down immediately, then the third one is he makes the crooked thing straight and he makes the rough road smooth. So he's doing four things to bring reality. And those four things that bring reality are designed to bring us into the presence of the Lord. Now I want to try to show you a picture. I don't know where I get the courage to do these things, but I want to try to give you a picture of something that is kind of almost humorous, and yet it was kind of scary. Now, what I'd like for you to go is to Luke 15, and let me show you something about how God is intending, designing to do this. Now, we begin in Luke 15. Where's Luke? Here we are. Luke 15, and it has to do with the prodigal. So when the prophetic word came tonight, I thought, isn't this interesting? Now, and I'm going to try to show you four kinds of pictures of how we are and how we relate to God, all right? The first one is Luke 15, verse 17. But when he came to himself, do you see the margin there? When he came to himself, all right? When he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired men have more than enough bread, but I am dying here with hunger, all right? Now, the first position that we have when we are a prodigal is we are below ourselves. The prodigal was below his normal self, his real self. He was living below that, down in the valley in the ravine. But there's an interesting factor, which was his brother. His brother was living above himself. He was a Pharisee. Now the brother was living way up here where nobody could touch him. And so he's a mountain or a hill. So the mountain or the hill and the valley or the ravine, one is below himself and the other one is above himself. And I see the father working on both of these boys. Are you there? So how many here have ever been below yourself? Man, we live there. For sometimes live there for long periods of time. And I know. So when he came to himself, now what? When he came to himself, he came back to his real self. Not below and what? Not above. He was his real self. Now, I'm going to say something to you. One night I was preaching, man, I had him walking on the ceiling. Man, God was on me and I was anointed and things were happening and I was coming. And I said to the Lord, no, Lord, that's my real self. The next night, the words dripped off my chin, fell on the floor. They didn't even go over the pulpit, you know. And then I heard the Lord say, no, that's your real self. So I suddenly understood what the issues were, all right? Now, once in a while, I get above myself. Now, the moment that I get above myself, like the Pharisee, I become pharisaical. And I'm not real. The moment that I get below myself, I get worldly, carnal. How many's minds going ahead of me now to say the son of the kingdom is what? The son of the kingdom is what? His real self. He's not religious, he's not worldly, he's just real. Wouldn't that be refreshing? Just real. When you touch him, he's real. He doesn't speak thee and thou. He's just real. He's not above, he's not below. He just is. He's just a real person. Now, it's not easy to dwell as a real person. And I got to be careful now. I'm going to get myself in trouble, all right? Now, let's go to the next scripture. And we're going to work on this. 2 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 2. Now, I started to laugh when I was working on this because I started to see, indeed, this is how it works. And then I got excited about it, all right? And I began to understand something that is, at least for me, this is unique, all right? And I started to get really see into this, and I began to understand why the tribulation. Why is it that it takes tribulation to enter the kingdom? Because the kingdom is reality. In order to dwell in reality, I can't be, and I can't be, I've got to be. And so in order for me to enter the kingdom, I have to endure. I said, who needs it? You do. And I thought, yeah, that's exactly what the Lord does. If I'm above myself, that's called Phariseeism or pride. Man, I have been there. In fact, I am the president of the Deeper Life Club. You can always tell the president of the Deeper Life Club because he carries a little tiny Bible in this pocket. There's another president over here somewhere. All right. Now, come on. This one is so real. And I thought, yeah, this is plain as the Bible can be. Look, 2 Corinthians 12, verse 2. I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago, whether he was in the body, I do not know, out of the body, I do not know, but God knows, he was caught up to the third heaven. So the third place we can be is outside of ourselves. Now, I'm not talking about soul travel now. I'm just talking about way up in the... Right? I'm talking about gone to the third heaven. Now, those of us who are really old-time Pentecostals and charismatics, man, we've seen some things. I've been to 2 hog callings and 3 county fairs. But I've had some real experiences where I was out of myself. See, and when I got out of myself, I was up in some spiritual realm, and God gave me a wife that helped me come back to earth. Sitting right over there. She said, where are you going? Oh, yes. Now, look with me at 2 Corinthians 12, verse 7. Now, I think maybe for the first time we might start understanding this. Because of the surpassing greatness of my trip, are you there? The Lord gave me a little messenger to bring me where? Down to where? To my real what? To my real self. Because he said, if God didn't do that, I continually had this tendency to go out of myself. Now, I know there's nobody here like that. But it's something to be married to that. Male or female. Said, where are you? I said, don't bother me, I'm praying. Whoa, he was out there somewhere. How quickly he came back. How quickly he came back to the real self. Now there's one more. I would love to fool with this a little bit and see, because what I saw was below myself was the prodigal, above myself was the Pharisee, the elder brother. Outside of myself is the man or woman who's had great spiritual experiences. The thing that scares me about great spiritual experiences is sometimes they injure you more than they help you, because we don't know how to handle them. So God is not able to give himself to us in ways that he wants to, because we're not mature enough to handle them. And so then we get spacey. Well, some of you may hear me tell that I heard a man that was coming who was in the Navy, and I got dressed and I wanted to go hear him, and this was about 1960 somewhere, and I went to hear him, and because he was a Navy man, I loved the Navy, and he got up and he was telling an experience that he had, and finally got to him, and the experience was 1941, and his whole life was built on one experience from 1941, and everything in his whole life had stopped. 1941, he stopped growing. Because he went out of himself and never came back. Now there's another one. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 13. This one's more applicable to many of us. Verse 13. Let's don't read it, huh? Let's don't read that one. Now, what's this one? Come on, what's this one? Beside ourselves. How many use that phrase? How many understand that phrase? I was beside myself. That's what a woman says when she got seven kids. I said, how you doing? She said, I'm beside myself. That means her physical body is standing here, and she's standing over here, God, crazy! How many here ever been beside yourself? Yeah. And now what? Above myself, below myself, outside of myself. What's the last one? Beside myself. And I thought, how am I ever going to find my real self? How am I ever going to find the real me? The guy that really, the one you touch. I have to be careful here, because the next verse teaches us something about being beside ourselves. Verse 14, for the love of Christ controls us. He said, if I seem like a crazy man, it's because The love of Christ is so deep in me, and it's the thing that controls me. He said, there's times when I feel like I could step right out of my body and get on with this thing. But he said, the love of God, the love of Christ controls me. And so I begin to feel something that's very, very sensitive to me. Now let's drill once more, because while I'm drilling is so for us to understand something. Now, I'm going to challenge you in a little while in a way you may not have been challenged for quite a while. But listen, below myself, say it with me, below myself, that's the prodigal. Above myself, that's the older brother. Outside of myself, that's the Apostle Paul. There was others. Peter, remember Peter's trance? He's on the thing, said, where were you? He said, man, I was out there. He said, I saw it. I saw the sheet. I saw the thing, man. And Peter said, and the Lord said, Peter, go with the people. And I love his message. He goes over to the people and he says, you know, I shouldn't be here. Doesn't that sound? I shouldn't be here. Now, say it with me. Now, I thought, I see that. Now, here's what I'm trying to say. In order to enter the kingdom, we have to find our real self. Now, let me talk to you for a few moments about what I would like to call children's bricks. What are children's bricks? Children's bricks are the things that I discover as I'm growing up, where I'm going to build an image of myself. So I take a hero, the Lone Ranger, right? The Lone Ranger or Shirley Temple. That dates us. Somebody don't even know who Lone Ranger was, all right? But the Lone Ranger was one of my heroes. I had some severe rejection as a little boy. And so I took the bricks and I made myself an image. And as I built my image, I built little Bobby Mumford. And I built it out of bricks and wood and hay and stubble. And I built it out of rejection and pain and a dad that didn't care. And I built it out of all the crazy things that was handed to me. And I built this thing and then I was going to defend it. And Jesus comes along and said, Bah, that's a mask. That's not the real you. The real you is different than all of that. And I said, no, it's not. That's me. That's the real me. Don't touch it. It's all I have. 3.5 months, I counseled a man. He was a homosexual, married, bisexual, actually. I counseled him, loved on him, worked on him. God, I wanted that man for the kingdom so bad. And the day came, I put him on a 7-day fast, and I fasted with him. I don't do that anymore. Let them fast now. But I fasted with him. Come to the 7th day, and I was going to pray for him, get him delivered. Man, the power of God was on me. The anointing was there, and I knew I had it, man. And he came in my office, and we prayed together. And I got up from my desk, and I went around like this to pray for him. And he jumped out of the chair, and he said, don't touch me. I said, what's the matter with you? He said, if you cast this thing out, I wouldn't know who I am. And I understood something. Many of us are sitting in that place tonight. We're afraid to death that God is going to change our image or reveal the real self. Now, when Jesus said, deny yourself, he didn't mean the real one. He mean the one you made, the created one. Little Bobby Mumford, he was a macho man. And when it was convenient, he was able to cry pretty easy because it was a controlling thing. So I built him. I built him out of all the material, the best material I had. I built him. And I built him up very carefully. Then I met God. And the Lord said, that's a mask. I said, it's not a mask. Everybody else believes it. You got to believe it too. And he said, nah. Now watch. The meticulous dresser. I know, man, I could give you his name right now. He would kill if you ever messed a hair up on his head. Meticulous. Spit and shine. Inside, he was full of anger. But outside was the meticulous dresser. And I looked at him, and I began to understand him. I liked him because I could see with God's eyes. I could see inside the little man, the little boy that wanted so bad to get out of there. But he built it, and I could tell you his story, and I'm ahead of myself, but this, listen, we build out of heroes and models, and we build out of failure and injury and rejectory, and then, now, careful, because what I'm going to do is build something. What I'm going to do is build something above myself, which is religious and pharisaical, or I'm going to build something which is mean and bad, and I'm a tattoo on my arm, born to raise hell. Right? And so I'm going to build something, and I'm going to build something above myself, or what? Below myself. David Wilkerson, we worked with David in early days, and he said, Bob, the thing that I recognize is this, when a young lady goes bad, she really goes bad. Because she's trying to build an image, something that she's going to be, and the ingredients that she has. Now, what do our kids have? What kind of ingredients do they have to build with? They build after the Rolling Stones, or Mick Jagger's, or Madonna. They take her life and they build it into her. Then they come out dressed with green hair and spikes on them. But God said, that's not the real you. I know that's a mask. And the Lord looks right through the mask and sees the real person. Aren't you glad? But it's also scary. Because when my mask started to come off, and I was frightened, because I had a macho hunter, big and bad. Perhaps my image is a redneck with a pickup truck and an axe handle. How many of you know he built that, right? He built that. Then he meets Jesus. Jesus says, I love you just like you are. I love you. That's only half the message. The other message is, I love you just like you are, but I'm not going to leave you like that. The other message says, I'm going to bring the... Now I'm going to put you on the fast track into the kingdom. And when you hit the kingdom, it's going to be ultimate reality. And you cannot remain like you are, because if you get into the kingdom in ultimate reality the way you are, you would turn out to be a piece of fried bacon. Am I talking to the right people? How many here have ever gotten close to reality and got scared? Come on, now, that's not rhetorical. Let me see your hand. Don't be bad. That's right, almost half of us. I said, I was in a prayer time one time, San Francisco, and I was praying, man. I fasted for days and days, and I was getting skinnier, and things were pressing. I said, God, I want to hear the wind of the Holy Spirit. I was a Pentecostal then. I said, I want to hear the wind of the Holy Spirit. I want to hear the wind. I want the wind of God to blow. And all of a sudden, I just go, whoosh. I said, that's enough. That's enough. That's enough. He didn't even get started. Reason was, I was in so much unreality. Am I getting through to you? So, we get this mask. Now, scripture says, the Lord looks right through the mask. He doesn't even pay attention. What impresses everybody else, the Father doesn't even look at. He looks right through to see the real you. Now listen to this. Those of you who attend here know this is one of the messages I carry. God deals with a man or a woman not the way they are, but the way they want to be. I'll repeat it. God Almighty reveals himself to us not by what we are, but by what we want to be. He sees the hunger, the desire, and he responds to that. Not the masks, not the image, not the boy that I build out all the little child's bricks. I build all this little Bobby Mumford. And Lord didn't receive him, loved him, but didn't leave him like that. Now, here's what I want to do. I want to go quickly because I'm taking more time on this than I intended, but I think this is very important. Now, the tribulation which we enter into the kingdom is very simple. It's made narrow by pressure. And as I press into the kingdom, the Lord says to me, that's not acceptable to me. Do you see what kind of a Pharisee you really are? And I said, Lord, I'm not a Pharisee. But what happened was, while I was in the Sunday school on my little painted chair, I took children's bricks and I built myself an image of what a good boy really is. I had Sunday school pins down to here. But he was a Pharisee. The Lord said, that's got to go. Got to go. But Lord, you don't understand. Let me explain it to you. Lord said, oh, I can hardly wait. But it's the same when I build a self that is above me is just as despicable to God as when I build a self that is below me. I've got to come to myself, the real self. When I come to the real self, I begin to see the real self. When I turn around and I look at the self I used to be, I begin to see it was made narrow by pressure. And there's been tribulation as God squeezed me and pressed me and made me come. The valleys come up and the mountains come down. He said, the thing that I demand from you is you be real. Now listen, real people get hurt. Religious people don't get hurt. Worldly people don't get hurt. Because they have all the defense mechanisms built in. Is this right? So real people get hurt. Because what's happened is the real person's hanging out. And when the real person hangs out, you touch him. I said, no, man, I ain't going back to what I used to know. Thee, thou. What happened to Bob? I don't know, but he's gone. He turned into a Pharisee. How many here know you can turn into a Pharisee in 24 hours? Sometimes 24 minutes. Turn into a Pharisee. All right, now quickly, we need to move because I need to get where we want to go. The created person, the Lord doesn't receive. The real you, the one that God is after, is the one he's after. Now, the tendency is to get religious and weird above myself, or get worldly and carnal below myself, or what's the third choice? Well, beside myself. I can't stand this Christian life. Why don't somebody sort it out and show me how it works? That's a good sign. You're beside yourself. And you think, what am I going to do with all this business? How does this thing really work? How does it work? Now, what I want to do, I hope I can do this with tenderness, but I want to do it, and then I need to get over to the answers, all right? Do you know the guy in the Peanuts cartoon called Pigpen? He is really dear, isn't he? You see, and he got that cloud of dust around him all the time. Now, it seems to me that what we're looking at is two choices. Pigpen, guy was leading songs and he said, when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. No. Okay. Now, I gotta keep my signals straight here. Now, Pigpen, and the other one, I hope I can do this with a straight face. The other one is what I call spiritual Dirty Harry. Carries a big 45 in here, and it's his job to keep the kingdom clean. Man, he is bad. Because this thing, and he has memorized all the books of the New Testament. And man, you just cross him one time. Whips out the sing. Now, I want to give you biblical evidence for what I'm saying. Dirty Harry in Jesus' crew was Peter. They came to take the master away, and he whips out his sword like this. Cuts the guy's ear off. How many understand when you cut somebody's ear off, you intended to cut their head off? Is that right? I mean, if you know anything about swordplay, you understand. He said, go ahead, make my day. And the Lord said, oh my goodness. And he went over and healed the guy. I don't know how many people God has had to heal because of this Dirty Harry. Because, man, I was so fast with the scriptures. I had them memorized. I knew. I studied cults. Anybody that was weird, I had all the verses. I said, interesting thing about cutting people's ears off is they can't hear the gospel. Right? I mean, they're done, man. It's all over now. Cut them both ears off. This is going farther than I thought it would go. Right? interesting thing about the disciples, and there's a spirit here that's really important, because I think we're in a transition time for the whole church of Jesus Christ. So what I'm after is very serious, though I appreciate the humor because it's helping me very much. I mean, it's helping me to get said what's in me, you know. But to hear, understand, that there were some Samaritans came by. May have been black, may have been Jewish, may have been Catholics, may have been Mormons, may have been Baptists. All right? But they weren't with us. Slide up beside the Lord and said, "You want us to call fire down on this?" Jesus said, "Oh my goodness, you don't know what spirit you're of." Now listen, this is what's scary. I want you to hear this. Spiritual Dirty Harry is a good spiritual gift motivated by a human spirit. If I told you how many mimeographed papers and tapes that I get from Dirty Harrys that's going to judge the whole world, judge the school system, judge the Democrats, judge the Republicans, judge the judges for Jesus. I get them, they come, man, they tell me, and almost all of them are out of the book of Amos. I said, "Did you ever read the book of Luke?" I understand, but listen, this is not where we're going. Spiritual Dirty Harry has ceased from following closely in the steps of his master. He's built an image of himself that is above himself. And it's his job to sort out everybody. And he sees himself or herself prophetically. That scares the bejeebers out of me. I said, don't take your model for being a prophet from the Old Testament. Take it from the New. Watch my master now in operation. Very simple story. They find a woman in adultery. Most of the commentators say it was a setup, that they actually set this up for this woman to trap her. What is that called in our law? Entrapment. Absolutely illegal. Then they quoted the scripture that says she needs to be stoned, where the quote is he and her needs to be stoned. So they bring him, and they bring him, and they bring her, and they throw him in the presence of my master. And my master said, "Listen and watch what I do." And I've read the story over and over, and I weep because I don't understand. But I do understand, but I don't know how to do it. That is, he has confidence in the mystery of the faith. He knew they were wrong. And he knew they knew they were wrong. So he never drew on them. He left his gun in the holster. Did he have one? Oh yeah, man. When it was time, he turned the tables over, threw the whole thing up. But he just left it in the holster. He said, "What happened?" He said, "We found her in adultery, and there she was. We caught her in the very act." He said, "Well," bends down, starts to write in the dirt, and I wish I knew what he wrote in the dirt. I think I could tell you, but it's a secret. But he's writing something in the dirt. Now, the mystery of the faith is working. Dirty Harry isn't functioning. The mystery is working. They all start getting convicted and shuffling in the dirt. And the oldest guy leaves first. Then he says, "Doesn't anyone condemn you?" She says, "No, master." He said, "Neither do I." He said, "Go and sin no more." Now listen, the end result of stoning her was so she wouldn't do it anymore. So he got the same result a different way. He said, "Don't do that anymore." She said, "Man, I won't." She loved him. She didn't even know he was carrying a 44. Because I'm saying, "God, now watch." Because what I'm after here is really, God. We're entering a new phase of the church. Now I want to quick give you five things so that these are five things you need so you can find your real self, and then I'm going to show you how to do it. All right, so we need to move along kind of quickly. How's our time? 8:30? Goodness sakes. All right, number one, I'll have to give you these quickly because I want to give you the direct, what I believe God's saying to us, all right? Number one, acknowledge our extremes. Mountains come down, the valleys come up, and God's love controls us when we're beside ourselves. So we do have to acknowledge, sometimes we build above ourselves, sometimes we're below ourselves, and God is working to keep us on the straight road. Number two, God's covenant love sees past all of this. And he deals with you not the way you are, but the way you want to be. So your confidence is in his covenant love. Number three, the anointing, the grace of God, the presence of God in the New Testament is an abiding relationship. You do not have to strive to keep the anointing. He on whom you see the Holy Spirit descending and abiding, that's the church. You don't have to strive. It's green pastures and still waters. Number four, abnormality prevents people from seeing Christ. When I'm below myself, when I'm above myself, people can't see Jesus. Is that clear? Let me repeat it. Abnormality, that is when I'm a Pharisee or when I'm Pigpen or Dirty Harry, whenever I'm either of those, people only see me and they see the hypocrite and they see the Pharisee and they don't see Jesus. Because I'm above it or below it, and they're not able to see the real person and see through me to see the Father. Number five, don't take the anointing with you. There's a lot of things in the church where people try to capture the anointing some way. Your goal is always to leave a deposit of God. See, not trying to take it with you. So, "Oh, Bob died and the anointing left." No. No, it was imparted. It was given. Very important. Now, quickly, I want to give you a couple things that's very, very significant. I believe God gave me these for this conference, and I'll give them to you quickly. Most of us know that the church, as we now know it, has lost its vision and power of the kingdom of God. The church, for the most part, is inbred and self-serving. And I'm a church man. You'll see where I'm going to go with this. Now, the difference between the church and the kingdom is what keeps me sane. If I only had a vision of the church, I would have quit.
tribulation I have endured and my spirit is still moving is because I see the kingdom of God. Now, when I see the kingdom, something has to happen to me. Now, here's what I'm going to ask you to do. I'm asking you in Jesus' name, as a son and daughter of the kingdom, go to church. Not because of what you can get. Now, I want you to picture something. One time I was going on KLM, Royal Dutch Airlines. I was feeling above myself. I had my briefcase and I got on the plane and they upgraded me to business class. It was all royal purple in there. Man, I felt like an ambassador. And I suddenly realized they're representing IBM, General Motors, and all the Fortune 500, and I was an ambassador of the kingdom of God. And the government was in my suitcase. It was a good feeling. Now, what this conference is designed to do is to do that. You're going to start seeing yourself as a son and daughter of the kingdom. Yeah, that's who I am. I'm a representative of the government of God. Yeah, that's who I am. Got my marching orders right here. Yes, sir. This is the Constitution bylaws of the kingdom of God. Now I'm going to church. And when I walk in, they gonna feel the kingdom vibes. Now, you know what I'm teaching you? I don't know where this tape's gonna go, but it's gonna get me in trouble. Do you know what? One son, one daughter of the kingdom that is not above himself, not below himself, but is real, can change a whole church. Come on now. Come on now. I see the Lord. One son, one daughter. How many know one bad kid in a class can disrupt the whole class? One son of the kingdom, one daughter of the kingdom walks into church, got that silly grin on his face or her face. They said, who are you? Say, oh, I just came, the Lord sent me. They get nervous right then. Now, the marvelous thing is, and I'm going to say this in a minute, this is pretty gutsy, but I'm going to say it. You didn't come there to get anything. The reason you get discouraged with church is because you go thinking you're going to get something. And you come back with cotton balls. Sure. And see, but if you didn't go to get anything, you just have your own little camp meeting all by yourself. Hallelujah. Praise God. Ooh, praise God. Wow. And they say, who are you? You say, oh, I'm just the real me. I'm just the son, daughter of the kingdom. What does that mean? Oh, you don't want to know. Get them frantic. It's called beside themselves. Right? They get frantic, man. Because they can't, there's no pigeonhole to put you in. Said, I thought you were a Presbyterian. I said, I am. Me and John Knox, yeah. If you go to church, you will suffer. And if you go to to church the way I'm teaching you to go to church, I promise you, you will find the real you. Because you'll be mad and glad all in the same meeting. You'll see yourself go above yourself, below yourself, beside yourself, and out of yourself in 1 hour. Goodness sakes. Okay. The church is his bride. If you love him, you have to love her. The church is his dwelling place, his temple. If you're going to dwell in his presence, you have to go to church. Number three, the church is his body. All that God does is through his body. Even parachurch organizations are now recognized. The only thing Jesus builds is church. Number four, the church is the seat of his government. Out from his church comes the authority of God. The church is our spiritual home. Blessed, blessed is the man or the woman who has a church that can say, "This is my spiritual home." Many people are trying to find that and cannot find it. Number six, the church is the means, the source, and the cause of maturity. You cannot mature with TV and a Bible and a rocking chair. You were baptized into water, and when you were baptized in the Holy Spirit, you were baptized into people. 1 Corinthians 12:13, you were baptized into the body. That's the baptism in the Holy Spirit. Number seven, the church is his army. If you don't go to church, the Lord's liable to call a war and you not get invited. You say, "Well, the church doesn't do anything for me." Now listen to these next 5 points. I'm going to give them to you quickly, and then we're going to have a chance to minister to you. Number one, I'm going to say these plain and straight so there's no confusion. Number one, the church's condition has no direct effect on your need for them. Did you hear what I said? The church's condition has no direct effect on your need for them. Number two, if you're not spiritual Dirty Harry. Number two, you are not personally responsible for the errors, weaknesses, and problems. Unless, of course, you're packing a 44 and it's your job to straighten everybody out. Number three, I'll repeat these since there's so much joy in this place. Number three, your responsibility as a son of the kingdom is just be there. And just being there, grace will be released. Just the fact that your presence is there as a spirit-filled son and daughter of the kingdom, just your presence will release the power of the kingdom of God. Just your being there, if you have faith for it. Number four, your personal presence, like leaven, brings influence. Influence is one of the highest forms of authority. Oh, the joy of being able to go into a church full of joy, full of the Holy Spirit, kingdom man, kingdom daughter, and just walk in there and sit down. And your very influence keeps it like salt from going bad. They'd do something weird if you weren't there. But just you're sitting there. I first got saved in the, when I was on the ship in the Navy, after dinner, we all would go out on the fantail of the ship and tell dirty stories. And I was one of the best. So after I got saved and I was filled with the Holy Spirit and I was all full of joy and everything, and they'd all be out there telling dirty stories, and I'd walk out and I'd say, "Hi." The whole thing would go, and I felt like I had leprosy. And I couldn't figure out what was wrong. What was it? What was it? My presence. I didn't say anything. I liked those guys. I just walked out there. I said, "Hi." They said, "My presence. My presence like iodine." That will make you suffer. You feel alone, feel rejected. You don't feel happy. But you are serving God. The utterance tonight, both of them said, "I'm calling a church, and you see the church now through my eyes. It's my bride, it's my body, it's my temple, it's your home." And you say, "Yeah, but look at it." The Lord said, "Don't you look at it. You just go be there. Pray in the Spirit and pray the arrow prayer and pray, 'God, have mercy on this thing. God, have mercy on this church. God, have mercy on the church.' When you pass the Methodist church, the Catholic church, pray for them. Visit them, Lord. Even if they don't want you." Everyone's heard the story about the guy got thrown out of the church and they threw him out, and he's sitting on the front steps, and the Lord came and said, "What's the matter?" He said, "Oh Lord, they just threw me out of the church." He said, "It's okay. They threw me out in 1948. Okay. Last point. As a son and daughter of the kingdom, you're normal. Whatever that is, Joe, we're normal. Not above, not below, just normal. Not trying to straighten everybody out, not trying to play Dirty Harry. Just normal. You just walk in there, feel secure. The real self is starting to emerge, and you're feeling pretty good about it all. And you don't even mind suffering. You really don't mind. It's okay. Because I know that out of this, the Lord is revealing himself to me, and I'm going to be able to dwell in his presence. And I'm going to act as salt and light, and my life is going to influence this thing. The Lord sent me to an Episcopal seminary. I was a rabid Pentecostal. I walked into the seminary and I said, "The Lord sent me." In an Episcopal seminary. 3 years on the dean's list. Till finally the students and the professors and all of them came to me and said, "Bob, tell us what it is. What do you have? I had to earn the right to give my testimony. Because I wasn't trying to be above, wasn't trying to be below, just trying to be what? Real. Just real. Just me. Real me. It's hard. I remember first time I went to an Episcopal altar for the Eucharist. As I knelt at the Episcopal altar for the Eucharist, the power of God came over me. I thought I was going to go. I literally did. I shook and trembled. I tried to hide it so the Episcopalians wouldn't see it. Shaken under the power of God, the elements was ministered to me. I was wild. And I thought, "Lord, you're really here." He said, "Oh, Mumford, didn't I say I fill heaven and earth?" Yeah. He's in your church. You just haven't found him yet. Now watch. Coming from this, you got to go down the mountain tomorrow. Right? We got to go back to the real world tomorrow. Take this tape with you and play it before you go to church. Get up, get all shined up, get your spirit of God, pray in the spirit, pray the arrow prayer, get yourself all fixed up and say, Lord, I'm not going there to get anything. I'm going there because it's your church, and I'm going because I am your son, your daughter, and I don't have any pride. I'm not talking about pride above or below. I just want to go because this is the place where you said this is your church, and I love your church. And then watch the Lord start to work. It's called kingdom vibes. And everyone says, where did you come from? Who are you? What are you doing? Nothing. I'm just here. Some people love it. Other people. And you understand both. Say it with me. Really? Your wife would love to meet the real you. I sat in a room with a woman who was speaking to me, but putting the heat on her husband. Well, Bob, I've told him he ought to get saved. And he's sitting over reading his paper, mad, hurting. She's talking to me, preaching at him. And I said, why don't you just get your gun, go shoot him? He didn't want what she had. He didn't want what she had. Because she was. They don't want when we have when we're. How many of you can see some suffering coming this year? Now, put your Bibles away. Let me see you stand right now. Come on. You see what's happening, don't you? You see what's happening just across this place? In the day of his power, scripture says God would allow us to volunteer freely. Now I want to be able to simply to pray for you. Then I'm going to ask for those who need the baptism in the Holy Spirit to come. We want to minister to you because you need the means of grace, which is called the baptism in the Holy Spirit. We'll have opportunity. And then following that, for those that can remain, we'll pray for the sick and those who've got particular needs. There's some special brothers and ministries here. We'll do that. I'm not just sure how I want to do that this moment, but first of all, we're dealing with finding my real self. Okay? Let's pray the Jesus prayer. Could we do it? Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Right now, here's what we're doing right this moment. Father, we're standing now in your presence. Best I've ever known of God walking up and down these aisles, writing your name and your address in his little book, so that this year he would know that you have volunteered to find the real self, the son of the kingdom, the daughter of the kingdom. Now, Father, I'm asking you for myself, for my Judith, for my children, for my grandchildren, for our family, for every church that is represented here, for each of us individually, none excluded, young or old, those of us who have been in the Lord a long time and those who are fairly new in God, Holy Spirit, I ask you to come right now and begin to work in us. Let the mountain be brought down and the valley be brought up and make a straight way for the Lord so we could find our real self. Now, would you just pray, ask the Lord yourself right there. Just pray out loud, do whatever you want. Just do business with the Lord for a few moments. Just right there, just pray yourself. Would you do that? Just deal with the Lord. Why would you stand in there? Let God deal with you. Lord Jesus, I desire to find my real self. I ask you to release me from any fear or any trepidation or any anxiety that you would treat me wrongly or harshly, but that you would open for me an understanding of myself and of your kingdom. Can we just worship the Lord together? Let's just worship in another tongue. Let's just enjoy the Lord. While these are being baptized in the Holy Spirit, would you just enjoy the Lord?